You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Monday, July 2nd, 2018. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Nisha Kapoor, author of Deport, Deprive, Extradite, 21st Century State Extremism. Also on the program today, over the weekend, thousands of people across the country protest the U.S. government's policy of child kidnapping. And south of the border, historic landslide as the left wins big in Mexico. AMLO. And I think 5 of 7 governorships. Meanwhile, the DOJ is planning to define asylum requests out of existence for Central Americans. Trudeau targets the GOP with his tariffs as Trump wants more tariff authority and proposes the FART Act. I'm not kidding. Meanwhile, Michael Cohen pleads with Trump for one last time. And in the run-up to Trump's Supreme Court announcement, Susan Collins pretends she cares about a woman's right to choose. New Jersey Dems finally pushed through a millionaire's tax. And it turns out North Korea sort of doing the opposite of denuking. And fortunately for Donald Trump, the Supreme Court nominee frontrunner happens to think presidents shouldn't have to face criminal charges while in office.
Naturally. Worked out well.
All that and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. Folks, I want to get this out of the way right off the bat, because sometimes on Twitter, maybe I am a slightly just too dry for some folks. I want to put up a tweet that I tweeted 13 hours ago, wherein I wrote, I voted for GWB twice. That would have been George W. Bush twice. Burned Dixie Chicks albums. Voted for McCain only because of Palin. Withstood the Kenyan socialist. Voted for Mitt. He was not a taker. Voted against Clinton because of Vince Foster. Now it's time for me to hashtag walk away from Democrats, hashtag walk away to hashtag MAGA. Folks, this was a satirical tweet. I did not vote for George W. Bush twice. I did not burn any Dixie Chicks albums. I did not vote for John McCain, not the least of which because of Sarah Palin. I did not feel that Barack Obama was a Kenyan socialist. I did not vote for Mitt.
I had the worst allergies when I burned the Dixie Chicks. the smoke was in my face.
My
friends from Texas were there, but they weren't burned, but I was.
I did not vote against Clinton. I do not think that she was involved in the murder of Vince Foster. I don't think Vince Foster was even murdered. And I was mocking the attempt to fabricate that there's some type of big hashtag movement on Twitter called Walk Away. And Dave Weigel posts via Place Boasis, here's another fake account trying to make Walk Away, the hashtag, happen. 16,000 retweets for a woman named Sophia Vagoros, who wrote, both my parents are Hispanic legal immigrants. Both were registered Democrats, and both this week told me they have decided to hashtag walk away. 16,000 retweets, 45,000 likes, and it turns out Sophia Vargas is not a real person. It turns out Sophia Vargas, in fact, doesn't exist. But Sophia Martinez, she exists. That's who whose picture it was, and she is the author of Penny Stocks. Exactly how to find penny stocks that can make you millions in the stock market.
Exactly how.
Yes.
Not loosely how.
Literally, this is how you do
But exactly how. What's up with your microphone?
I don't know.
There it is. Wait a sec. Try it again.
Test. Oh.
Somehow. We got a little, okay. So there it is. So, not so much walk away. It's sort of pennies, hashtag penny stocks. So I just wanted to make that clear. If there was any confusion for folks, I think probably if you see me claim to have voted for George W. Bush twice, or you know what, even once.
That was a graduate level joke, though, to be fair.
Was it really?
No, it was not. That was literally like a junior varsity joke. You're being way too generous.
I don't think that was the level of sophistication. I think was definitely a high school, maybe junior high level.
But gotta stick with JV. Junior high.
I'm not sure you understand how JV works.
Junior varsity sports teams.
Right.
Yes.
That would not necessarily be junior high.
Really?
No.
High school kids are still in JV?
You can, as a junior.
Oh, that's terrible.
Wow.
I didn't go to school.
This is that awkward time when we remember Michael was homeschooled.
What are you doing to Mike?
Folks.
Disgusting. I still host on Thursdays.
Folks. Learning a new language is a journey. It can be challenging, but it's ultimately one of the most rewarding experiences a person can have. The best way to reach your goal, whether that be a basic understanding or full-on fluency, is to immerse yourself in the language. Finally, there's a way to do that online from the comfort of your own home. Thanks to LiveLingua, LiveLingua offers immersive online languages via Skype. Their instructors are all native speakers of the language they teach. They work with you one-on-one. They don't offer some trendy new gimmick. 5 minutes a day is not going to make you fluent in a month, no matter what anybody says. But if you're looking to learn one of the most, the 11 most commonly spoken languages, I wonder what those 11 are.
Arabic, Mandarin, Spanish. Those are definitely three. English, obviously, but that wouldn't apply to us.
No. French.
Yeah, French from through
absolutely
Africa.
French.
Yep.
I wonder if you're like
Russia,
Dutch,
Russia
Russian,
just by landmass.
Maybe German. I would be surprised if it's German, but maybe 11. I don't even think I can name 11 languages off the top of my head.
Well, think of Portuguese? Other colonial. Yeah, Portuguese definitely. Other colonial powers in Africa. That's where we would.
Yeah, so I said Dutch.
Yeah, Dutch. Oh, you said Dutch. Okay, yeah, then Dutch is definitely there.
Well, nevertheless, folks, LiveLingua follows the immersive language method that diplomats and educators have been using for hundreds of years, but they do it online. So you can build a routine and comfort zone that works for you specifically. On Skype, students work one-on-one with their teachers, meaning there's no intimidation or, you know, slowing down for the guy in the back end of the class. I'm not going to point any fingers. Their immersive method increases memorization and finally helps a new language be part of your life. We'd like to invite listeners to the Majority Report to check out LiveLingua's platform. You can sign up for a free trial lesson today at livelingua.com/majority. That's livelingua.com/majority. You get a free lesson. Check it out. You got nothing to lose. All right, and this is... I sat down with my daughter some time ago. I don't want her to buy that much stuff, but she's always sending me links of stuff that she wants me to buy. And I'm like, dude, did you check for a coupon? That was what would happen in my house for an extended period of time. Did you check for a coupon online just to try and teach her? Like, why? It'll take you 5 minutes, and then it starts to get more difficult. And well, when you shop online, do you turn into a tab hoarder, loading dozens and dozens of new tabs in your browser in search of a promo code? Just one that works? That was me. But before you crash your browser yet again, try Honey. Honey is the free browser add-on that over 9 million people are using every day to save money while they shop online. You add the Honey to your browser for free, and then you shop like you normally do. Honey scans and tests millions of coupons in the background, then automatically applies the best coupon at checkout. Time Magazine calls Honey basically free money. Why? You save $5-$10? Why wouldn't you do that? I just did that for, I'm not going to say the name of the card place, but we're all getting business cards here. We're upgrading, getting a little more professional. And
it's going to be like American Psycho.
I saved.
Yeah.
I saved like $10.
And you didn't have to use your web browser like that.
There you go.
Yeah.
It's nice. There's no reason not to add Honey to your browser today. It's free. It takes two clicks to install. It will save you tons of money. Get Honey for free at joinhoney.com/majority. That's joinhoney.com/majority. joinhoney.com/majority. Start saving with Honey today. joinhoney.com/majority. All right, folks, we have time for this. Yeah, we do. Let's just do this briefly. Donald Trump. Now, look. I would be careful about passing around this thing on Facebook that's going around that my sister had sent me about Donald Trump and Anthony Kennedy's son, who just very coincidentally has a close relationship with Donald Trump because he was the one who signed off on a lot of his loans at Deutsche Bank. I think there's stuff there to look into. And there are people who are calling for maybe some investigations on just how this process went down with Anthony Kennedy. But I wouldn't get out ahead of yourself. The real issue for the time being is that Donald Trump is going to appoint someone to the Supreme Court who is going to change the tenor of the Supreme Court for decades to come. And not the least of which is going to be a woman's right to choose. They may not directly overturn Roe v. Wade. People I'm starting to talk to say they don't need to do that. They can simply allow multiple different ways for states to abridge a woman's right to choose, to effectively outlaw it, but not having to address Roe v. Wade head on. Not to mention that this guy, Brett Kavanaugh, who is first in line, supposedly at the top of the list, a former Kennedy clerk, after his experience working on Ken Starr's investigation, where they actually ended up getting Bill Clinton impeached because during a deposition, he lied about whether or not he had sex with Monica Lewinsky. He's now come to the conclusion that this is probably too much of a burden on a president. Well, here is Donald Trump talking about Roe v. Wade and his next Supreme Court pick.
Which means he had confidence in me to do the right thing.
Are you going to ask your nominees beforehand how they might vote on Roe versus Wade?
Well, that's a big one, and probably not. They're all saying, don't do that, you don't do that, you shouldn't do that, but I'm putting conservative people on, and I'm very proud of Neil Gorsuch. He has been outstanding. His opinions are, you know, is so well written, so brilliant.
Pause it. Now, obviously, Donald Trump has not read a single word of those. In fact, it was reported over the weekend that Donald Trump wants his nominee to have extensive writing on legal issues. He's not interested in reading them. He just literally wants to see that they exist because that's what's important. Yeah, I don't need the mucky muck gobbledygook. But if it's written and typewritten and it's
published
like
a lot of stuff,
that's good.
Lots.
I even learned a few words.
Standing his opinions are, you know, is so well written, so brilliant. And I'm going to try and do something like that, but I don't think I'm going to be so specific in the questions I'll be answering. And I'm actually told that I shouldn't be.
Because on the campaign trail, you said you would leave it to the states.
Well, maybe someday it will be to the states. You never know how that's going to turn out. That's a very complex question. The Roe v. Wade is probably the one that people are talking about in terms of having an effect. But we'll see what
Pause
happens.
Pause it. Did you follow how little of an understanding he had about all he, I mean, he was able to say the words Roe v. Wade and the words states, and that people are still trying to figure out how that has an effect.
It's very complex, okay?
He doesn't understand the concept of you have federal law supersedes, the Constitution supersedes law.
Well, a lot of people are talking about that whole principle as well.
That's right.
There's a lot of conversations going on about a lot of things involving
federal
and state laws. Things that are coming back, things that are going, but we're talking about it. And maybe I shouldn't say more.
Totally coming back.
You know, Wade is probably the one that people are talking about in terms of having an effect. But we'll see what happens. But it could very well end up with states.
There it is. Yes, it could very well end up with states.
Tune in to see what happens.
Yeah, as we mentioned the other day, Jeffrey Toobin predicted that abortion will be outlawed within 18 months in about half the states in the country, maybe a little bit less. Which I think in one form or another. I mean, look, there's not that far to go for at least a half a dozen states as it is now, where they have such a restrictive abortion laws. But things like trap laws, where you require onerous licensing and issues like that, these are what you're going to see first. And there's going to be a series of cases. The day whoever this white man becomes the next Supreme Court justice, and I'm going to bet it's probably going to be a white man.
Yeah, I know North Dakota has one. I mean, this might have gotten better. I doubt it. But North Dakota has one clinic, and it's in Fargo, and they'll find a way to restrict that.
Absolutely.
And I would not be surprised if they also passed a law to make it illegal to cross state lines to get an abortion.
You know, that's what I have been asking people, if there's going to be a way of doing that. And supposedly, it would be extremely difficult to pass such a law. But that was the first thing that occurred to me, if there could be a federal statute to that effect. But that seems difficult. But listen, they could pass the law in these states, and maybe they wouldn't be challenged, or they would just be on the books. It'd be one of those laws that don't get enforced. But who knows? Who knows where we'll be in a year from now in that regard? But
They probably know they don't need to, because the economic barriers are so great already.
That's right. That's the whole point. And
now there will be the fucking revolution.
There you go. And then the revolution comes. Folks, speaking of which, you can become a member of the Majority Report at jointhemajorityreport.com. Every day, it's a little revolution.
Sam did vote for George Bush at least once.
Twice.
It's okay.
Twice. Yeah.
The first time he wanted to restore civility. The second time he was concerned about managing the invasion of Iraq.
I was actually a little bit more concerned about who I want to have a beer with. And and George Bush just seemed like the type of guy I'd want to have a beer with.
Hate folks, you guy.
Jointhemajorityreport.com, pennies a day. And as a way of saying thank you, we give you bonus material. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, a lecturer from the University of York, Nisha Kapoor, on Deport, Deprive, Extradite, 21st Century State Extremism. We'll be right back.
You can rely on me, honey. You can combine anything you want. I'll be around. You write about the stars. Each one is a setting sun. Tall buildings shake, voices escape, singing sad, sad songs. Tuned to chords strung down your cheeks, bitter melodies.
We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program a lecturer from the University of York, Nisha Kapoor, author of Deport, Deprive, Extradite, 21st Century State Extremism. Welcome to the program, Nisha.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
Let's start with, you know, obviously you've written this book primarily about the experience of both immigrants and the war on terror in the context of Britain, primarily. Where do you see, before we get into sort of the details of your book, but where do you see the relationship between Britain and the United States policies in this regard?
So the book is about the cases of a group of men who were extradited from Britain to the U.S. For terrorism-related offenses. Although the book's focus, as you say, is mostly about Britain, there's a lot to be said for the way in which the U.S. and the U.K. work in collaboration with each other around counterterrorism policy and practice. And actually, Britain's been really instrumental kind of globally for helping develop countering violent extremism policy that's been used elsewhere. And the US has certainly borrowed from Britain in some of its approaches to dealing with terrorism in the US context. So there's certainly a lot of collaboration in terms of political approaches, in terms of policy, and it works both ways. There's lots of policing expertise that's borrowed from the US as well in counterterrorism, but in general policing context too.
So in terms of tactics, the countries share, I guess, tactics. But in terms of like a strategic framework, has the United States, in many respects, followed a framework that has been sort of grown up through Great Britain?
The way in which counterterrorism policy works is certainly global, and of course it's very much connected to the US and Britain's foreign policy and imperialist interventions in various parts of in other places across the world and across the Muslim countries in particular, but I guess in terms of thinking about the framework in terms of how counterterrorism is used domestically, then Britain's history in terms of dealing with Ireland, its history of having to of developing a counterterrorism policy within its own borders, within its domestic sphere, has been sort of really important for its own way of trying to deal with terrorism at home, and therefore producing expertise that's kind of been used and borrowed to be applied in other domestic contexts in the West, basically. So it's that's simply that, sometimes the way in which kind of military operations can be used freely in occupied spaces, in Iraq or Afghanistan or elsewhere, can't be used so openly in the sort of domestic context. And so alternative approaches are used, and that's why kind of Ireland and Britain have been quite important for the US in some senses for developing kind of counterterrorism. But equally, practices that have been used in Iraq and Afghanistan and so on, are also very important.
I want to talk about some of those alternative programs, but let's go back and start with Windrush. Tell us because I don't think most folks in our audience would know any of this history, for the most part. I don't want to if people do, but I certainly wasn't aware of it.
So what just just generally what it is?
Or yeah, yeah. History? I mean, well, walk us through its history and what you know, how it and why you included it in your explanation of what's going on here.
Okay, so I mean, I don't talk explicitly about Windrush in the book, but I did respond to the recent political debates and discussion that have been quite prolific in the British context around Windrush. And so I'll just explain for your listeners that recently it's come to light in Britain that a number of elders, people of the Windrush generation, people who migrated to Britain in the 1950s from the Caribbean, from Jamaica and elsewhere, are being deported because they have no official proof of nationality. And this is because when they were migrating to Britain, they were migrating to Britain as British subjects under, you know, as a legacy of kind of British Empire, and the formal ways in which as British citizens, but the formal ways in which citizenship has the policy documents that we now that kind of have come to be quite routine in terms of granting citizenship weren't in operation. So there's lots of people who migrated to Britain from the Caribbean, from parts of Africa, from South Asia during that period, who live in Britain and have citizenship, but who don't necessarily have the paper documentation to prove it and haven't kind of followed up with getting
hello.
That immigration policies are in place currently in the British context, it has meant that which require individuals to have proof of a British passport, of British citizenship, to access, you know, health and welfare services, but and also just, you know, for sort of immigration purposes, have been threatened with or actually been deported on the back of the kind of more recent immigration policy. So there's been kind of a huge uproar against the treatment of this generation who are being deported wrongly, who are in fact British citizens. My sort of response to some of the ways in which this debate has played out is that sometimes the critique hasn't sufficiently addressed the ways in which individuals who are here, who are here as immigrants but don't necessarily have British citizenship, are being treated through the immigration system, so are being deported. But also the ways in which numerous numbers of Muslims who are British citizens are and have been stripped of their citizenship, or removed or had their passports cancelled because they're being criminalised through terrorism legislation. We don't hear so much in the way of kind of a response, a critique about this, because there's a general kind of consensus of support for counterterrorism policy. So it doesn't get the same kind of anti-racist response.
Right. Well, and the point is, and I think, you know, you make this point, I think, in your book, is that these things build on each other, and you build you expand society's willingness to accept one thing, and that becomes a building block to expand those policies and so I mean, and I think we're seeing this in this country as well, when you start with the anti undocumented immigrant push, and then you expand that to people who are here under a program because they may be coming from a country that has suffered a natural disaster, and then that begins to expand to, we're going to take in less asylum seekers, and then it's going to, we're going to go back and review the documents of existing and so on and so on, and these things build on each other. Let's talk about the development of the deprivation of citizenship under the auspices of counterterrorism, and sort of, I guess these are sort of the canaries in the coal mine, in a way.
Yeah, right. So much of the kind of recent uproar against the sort of deportation of citizens in this country is kind of misses the point that since 2002 we've had a massive intensification in Britain of powers of legislation that allows for individuals to be deprived of their citizenship, and this has been this has been legitimated through counterterrorism policy, right? Through policy, through legislation that has specifically targeting individuals who are being accused of or who are identified as terrorism suspects. And because it's been passed through a sort of terrorism, the counterterrorism narrative, it's largely gone and it's not just gone unchallenged, but it's there's been a sort of a popular support in certain quarters for it. So we had an Islamic preacher called known as Abu Hamza al-Masri, who in 2002 was identified by the press, by the media in this country as being kind of one of the extremist preachers resident in Britain, kind of this domestic Osama bin Laden, who, who needed to be, who should be deported, who was counter to kind of British values and British ideas and the things that he was preaching and, was hugely problematic as a figure. And the Home Secretary in this country receives a raft of letters from the British public demanding that he be deported. But because he was a British citizen, he couldn't be deported. And so on the back of this, the Home Secretary says, something else needs to be done. And legislation is passed which lowers the threshold, which eases the ability for the Home Secretary to deprive an individual of their citizenship. And then in 2006, the legislation is enhanced again so that you can be deprived of your citizenship if the Home Secretary decides it's conducive to the public good to do so. And in 2014, on the back of another terrorism case, the British government passes some immigration legislation which says that individuals can be deprived of their citizenship even if they don't have citizenship elsewhere. So can be effectively made stateless if the Home Secretary believes that they can acquire it elsewhere. So another guy, another case that I talk about, Min Pham, who's extradited to the U.S. in 2015, is extradited and deprived of his citizenship at the same time. And he doesn't have any other citizenship. Vietnam, where he left when he was 1 month old, doesn't recognize him as a citizen. And so through this kind of counterterrorism legislation, through this sort of counterterrorism policy and assault, we've one of the things that's happened is this massive growth of powers, massive enhancement of kind of state powers to be able to deprive individuals of their citizenship. And these are measures that Britain led the way on globally, but, there are parallels that have been sort of used or discussed in, Australia and Canada and in other parts of Europe. And elsewhere. So because these aren't empathetic figures, they haven't really attracted any kind of, not very much contestation.
So I want to go backwards here a little bit so that people really understand, what is problematic about this, because you create these, it's almost like you're creating, I don't know, there's all sorts of different metaphors I think people could use, but you're creating almost like these new neural pathways for the way of depriving people of their citizenship, of the way of deporting people. And you're doing it for people who, from the perspective of it's the easiest sell. But once they're created, right, they exist, and they can. And then the question is, who all of a sudden, not whether or not we have the power to do this, but who right. are we going to do it to? And that's the right. dynamic that we're seeing here. So, just walk us through. You say, and I want, just so that people understand, the Home Secretary is the, I don't know if we have necessarily an equivalent in this country who would have that kind of authority, but nevertheless, I guess maybe the DOJ, maybe the Attorney General would have something similar to this. But,
yeah.
But just take us from where what was the baseline? Like, was there even a concept of being able to deny an individual their citizenship? you know, unless there was, you know, some type of problem with the way that they became a citizen? I mean, did that exist prior to this? And then we see the myriad of ways it becomes chipped away.
Yeah, so there is some powers on the books, but they're very weak, and they haven't been, you know, they were used, I think, literally very rarely, hardly at all, even since before the Second World War. So, I mean, there is some ability to do this, but they're very limited in power, and it has seldomly been used. Even after the power is passed in this country in 2002, it's only used against Abu Hamza, and it becomes informally known as the Hamza Amendment because it's in his name that it's passed. It's informally known in that way by lawyers who are aware of it. But it's only really after 2010 that it comes to be used a bit more frequently, and it's always been used against Muslims These aren't kind of large, you know, these aren't the numbers. It's still only a small number of cases relative to the number of people, for example, who are being deported. But the point is, as you say, that the powers are there, and that it's actually gone hand in hand with a bigger discourse, a bigger idea that citizenship is a privilege, not a right. So this has become very normal, right? This has become normalized to kind of think about citizenship in this way. So the things that are happening against these, you know, these men who are at the sort of extreme end of state, brutality of state disciplinary powers, aren't things that are going to happen to everybody. But the point is, it alters the. First of all, we have to talk about the injustice against these specific cases in and of themselves, right? For themselves, I think that's important to say. But also that it has a kind of broader impact in that it changes the very nature of how we come to think about social justice, how we, you know, how democracy comes to be practiced, and you know, how our kind of the various sort of state functions operate too. So yeah, I mean, partly it's to talk about the sort of what happens to these particular people, but also to think about what the consequences are for the way in which society is structured, the way in which the state is kind of operating, and the greater powers, the authoritarian nature of what's happening. So the greater kind of powers are being awarded to the state through this process.
And I should say that in the United States, because we have a constitution, essentially, I think, and because our citizenship is defined within the context of the Constitution, if you're a natural born citizen of the United States, you cannot have it revoked by anybody but yourself, really. But the dynamic is the same, right? I mean, that is the point that you're making here, is that they say a slippery slope, but it's the frog boiling in the water and not quite aware. Are there different sort of like facets to this in terms of the psychology of those in government and the psychology of those outside of it? I mean, I keep drawing parallels here to the United States, but we had a program under the Obama administration of detaining families at the border as a deterrent to, you know, for people to come up here and to seek asylum. And it seems to me that both our lack of concern as a society was problematic about that measure, and what it taught, like literally the people working in these agencies, as to what were the bounds in which was appropriate, you know, was okay. And I mean, talk about that in the context of what we've seen in terms of counterterrorism.
Yeah. So we have something very, yeah. So, you know, we have detention centers, that are used to lock up asylum seekers, you know, who are in the process of claiming asylum, and you know, same detention centers are being used for those for those citizens like the Windrush generation who are being, who are now sort of being deported or who can't prove their sort of residency or can't prove their legal status. Very much this isn't, when we're talking about kind of the state, to some extent there's the sort of element of power that's operating at the level of legislation and policy, but it's absolutely dependent on, regular folks, people who are working in the various different institutions. Some of these are private sector institutions, border agency staff and so on. But, very much also individuals working in health, what's happening here, and I imagine it's something similar in the US, is that immigration control is being... or immigration policing is being kind of broadened, and responsibility is being placed on landlords, on doctors, on nurses, on teachers, on higher education staff, on lecturers, on academics, on people who work in various different public institutions to monitor people's immigration status, for whom they are delivering a service or for whom they are working with, and there's consequences for not adhering to home office policy, the policies of the equivalent, say, of the Department of Justice for ensuring that these that immigration law is being implemented correctly. So it and that's similarly, that's very much the case with the way in which counterterrorism policy is operating, right? So when you asked me at the beginning about some of the frameworks, obviously one of the biggest is prevent, and that's something that's been developed in the British context, which has been kind of rolled out in various ways elsewhere. And so this is very much about kind of, racial profiling, policing based on suspicion. It has resonances with COINTELPRO. It's about kind of trying to identify any kind of behaviors, or practices or changes in, political views, for example, of Muslims, and sort of documenting those and assessing those and sort of monitoring those to see, in order to kind of make interventions lest they lead to radicalization. And this is a policy that has, the education sector teachers are being expected to sort of enforce, but social workers, doctors, mental health professionals, individuals who are charged or who we think of as being kind of caring or as, doing as kind of wealth, playing a sort of welfare or supportive or educative role ordinarily in our children and young people's lives are actually being tasked with doing kind of policing, which is one of the ways in which counterterrorism policy is operating so effectively in spaces where it's not being done by, say, the military all the time. It's kind of being done, through our education institutions.
I mean, these are like, counter-revolutionary committees, the equivalent of, right? Like these sort of like internal, everyone is becoming weaponized in some fashion. I mean, so that there's really two tracks, right? It's expansion of what the state can do to its citizens, and then it's expansion as to what the apparatus to do those things is.
Right.
And where, I mean, do you have a sense of, and maybe it's more generic than this, but do you have a sense of there being a, how you measure, the taxonomy of this? I mean, if counterterrorism, if terrorism suspects. And what the government can do to them is sort of the canary in the coal mine. Like what? And then immigrants become, I don't know, the cat in the coal mine. What's the next? I mean, where does it usually go? Is there, is it just a question of the most vulnerable who happen to be in that, in society? Or is there a... in your sense, a sort of almost a timeless notion of who the next sort of group of people are?
This is why it's so important to sort of think and speak and be aware of what racism is, right? And how race is so important for understanding how these different kind of disciplinary and policing practices work. Because it's what happens to, what happens to sort of who the sort of most marginalized or outcast or targeted are, who is racially kind of demonized or marginalized, is something that changes in different social contexts. It's something that changes over history. Obviously, there are some forms of racialization which persist much, are much more kind of ingrained or sort of held over huge long periods of history and over time. You can think about the sort of experiences of African Americans in the U.S. context. But I think what's important to recognize is that what happens to the sort of most demonized or outcast is not ever going to be the way in which power works. Is that it's never going to be kind of universally implemented. So there may well be other marginal groups that are next. The working class, the broader sort of working class. So often what happens or what gets experimented on in sort of asylum policy, it gets then infiltrated into the general welfare state, right? So whether that's about kind of vouchers, whether that's about in Britain, they started dispersing asylum seekers around the country so they weren't all congregating in London. And then you see housing policy in Britain in the broader sort of welfare, social services sector, following the same kind of trend, and similarly with sort of credit vouchers and food stamps, things like that are first of in the British context are first of all experimented with through the asylum in terms of how asylum seekers are dealt with, and then these things get rolled out. So there definitely is a kind of a ways in which these things become kind of normalized or extended. But the point is, I think, that we need to sort of say, well, actually these are huge, what's happening here is a huge issue around sort of social injustice. So, if we want to be, advocating for a more egalitarian, more equal, more just society, then we need to be lobbying against what's happening to these people just because it's happening to these people, right? So, and criminalization is so important as well in terms of sort of thinking about there is such a requirement for sort of critical response to the ways in which individuals are criminalized through counterterrorism policy, through immigration policy. And I think certainly with the former, there has just been so much, such a lack of kind of public discussion and engagement. Because there's always a sense that, if they're being accused of such and such a crime, then it's, obviously there needs to be some kind of repercussion or some kind of response, and the debate often stops there.
Is there a danger in just looking at the sort of the systemic implications of this? I mean, because it occurs to me, and obviously I'm using the States as an example because I'm more intimately aware of it. But, today we're detaining and essentially kidnapping the children of people who are seeking asylum in the States. And tomorrow it could be people who we decide to put through denaturalization process. Oh, okay. Everybody who we have 2,000 people that we have found who filled out their forms incorrectly 5 or 6 years ago or 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. We're going to put them through a process, and we're going to separate. We're going to take their children and put them into the system. And at what point, the idea that this is a system that's being built and it's going to begin to snare ever more people, it cuts both ways. Because if you are a member of society where you're like, well, I know it's never going to happen to me. Maybe it's not, maybe that's not the only reason to be concerned about it.
I mean, we have to, I guess we have to, it's important. We have to encourage some public debates and understanding and just knowledge and information over what's kind of presented in the majority of the sort of mainstream media about these issues, and then the actual realities for the individuals who are, you know, who are being criminalized or who are, you know, who are being targeted through these measures. To kind of put, to get sort of alternative narratives out there over what, you know, what the implications are and kind of what this is really about. So, if we think about sort of the discourses or the ideas around sort of terrorism, one of the things I'm obviously playing with in the book is that it's not to deny the very real issues around sort of political violence, but it is to say that most people who have been criminalized, most Muslims who have been criminalized as through counterterrorism legislation or who are being identified through in databases as terrorism suspects, you know, are being, you know, there's no evidence against any of these individuals. They are being preemptively policed. They are being profiled, and there are significant consequences for individuals wrapped up in this. And, you know, at the most extreme end, it has meant that, you know, there have been people extradited to Britain, there have been to the US without any kind of real due process, who are being detained in solitary confinement for three years pre-trial and then they typically enter a plea bargain, or who are, you know, denied any kind of sense of due process, who are being stripped of their citizenship and then killed by drones, or who are being denied all kinds of things that we would normally or ordinarily consider as automatic human rights. There's a kind of whole alternative narrative to be told around these individuals who have been criminalized, in order to sort of help us reframe stories about kind of what's actually happening here. Why is there a need to kind of keep enhancing these sort of disciplinary techniques? You know, what are they doing? Whose interests are they actually working in? And why? And what are the consequences of that?
Nisha Kapoor, the book is Deport, Deprive, Extradite, 21st Century State Extremism. Thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right, folks. Going to take a quick break and then head into the fun half of the program. We have a lot of sound. We have a lot of things, obviously, to discuss as Donald Trump starts to wind up. He's announced July 9th will supposedly be the day he announces who his Supreme Court pick will be. And really, I mean, all eyes have been focusing on Susan Collins to see if she will, in any respect, stand up for a woman's right to choose, like she's been pretending she would do for the totality of her Senate career. This is probably the first time that she will actually have to where there will be consequences for her vote, dramatic consequences. I mean, obviously, as she justified voting for Neil Gorsuch, this is going to be one where I think she won't be able to get away with it.
Tune in, folks.
Exactly. We'll see. Just a couple other quick notes before we head into the fun half. Finally, folks, after 30 years of being deprived the opportunity to kill red wolves in North Carolina, the Interior Department last week announced a plan that would allow private landowners to kill wolves that stray onto their property from a protected federal wildlife refuge. If you are living in a protected federal wildlife refuge as a, say, a red wolf, and you just don't, you can't, you don't know where you're just walking around and you happen to stumble on somebody else's property, you must have the personal responsibility to realize that you can't get away with that.
It's a national security issue.
It's a national security issue. My understanding is that there are only 35 of these red wolves left.
Probably 34 now.
Right.
Trump Jr. is going to definitely bag one of those, I think.
Yes. The service's new objective, said Leopoldo Miranda, assistant director for ecological services in the agency's southeast region, would be to intensively manage a smaller population of 10 to 15 red wolves at the refuge to preserve their genetic value and wild behaviors in the hopes that officials can find a location more friendly and suitable than eastern North Carolina. So they will be removed. Thank God.
Sleep easier.
It's just shocking.
They just want to be able to give more individualized attention to each wolf, okay?
That's right. And you can't, with 35 running around, it's like herding cats, never mind wolves.
Some SJW wolves over there.
Quality over quantity.
Want to make it all about how they're red wolves.
One bit of good news. The U.S. ambassador to Estonia resigned. And he was a career diplomat named James D. Melville. He served as a diplomat for 33 years, has been ambassador to Estonia since 2015, was due to retire soon anyways, but said in a private Facebook post announcing his retirement that Trump's behavior and comments accelerated his decision. So, I mean, we need more people of conscience to quit this administration. I mean, I think the idea now of like people staying on, and I would say like in some agencies there might be some value, because if you can slow the roll of these psychos, then by all means do it. But for ambassadors, for people of any sort of like high profile, this is good. I hope there's a lot more that leave.
I know at least four people who do human trafficking networks who will take that job to Estonia in a heartbeat. It means nothing. Owning the libs.
Do you really even think like he could
think that quickly of what Estonia is?
Estonia?
No.
What?
But I'm sure that somewhere it's
Estonia. Estonia.
But it's connected with human trafficking in his mind.
I'm sure.
Is that one of those
places that isn't paying enough for NATO?
Yeah. Is that one of those? No, it's like, are they not paying enough for NATO, or was it an Epstein party? I don't know. Or both.
Can't remember.
Can't remember.
Folks, before we go, and you may want to stick around for this, because we have a special version of La Poupée today. It involves La Poupée will play underneath a Facebook Live video. And someone cut this up, right?
Yes. Yeah, this is a Ken Jack.
Ken Jack on
it's from Barstool
on
Sports.
Twitter. From Barstool Sports, cut up a Mark Zuckerberg live stream from his backyard talking about barbecue. And this thing is pretty insane.
It's really uneasy.
Just a reminder, your membership makes this show possible. Become a member at jointhemajorityreport.com. If you cannot afford a membership, and however, you do want the extra content, by all means, send us an email at majorityreporters@gmail.com. Wait an intolerable amount of time for us to get to the email, and we will hook you up. I apologize for those waiting for email responses. We will get there, I promise. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off. They have I think they still have that cold brew I'm going to try that. Everybody's, it's all cold brew now. And they have a special, like, coffee that is amenable to being brewed coldly. I know you can buy a little cold brew thing, but you need coffee for it, don't you? I don't know if you can buy that at Just Coffee. Brendan's very excited.
No, you don't.
Brendan has his own little cold brew device. I think we got one here, too. I think I brought it, but I think it's one cup at a time. Also, today is Monday, which means that tomorrow, July 3rd, is Tuesday. That is 4th of July Eve, as we call it around here. And is there going to be a special TMBS for 4th of July?
Well, the special was Sunday, the illicit history for patrons on Thomas Paine, the leftist founding father. But tomorrow, the
You're
show...
You're just going to ignore the birthday of this country, the independence.
It'll be in there. It'll be in there. It'll be noted. It almost doesn't need to be said. Chris Morano is a labor reporter for the Jacobin. We're going to talk about Janus and the future of labor organizing. And then Bree Joy, who's a crew, obviously, and also politics editor, Intercept, is going to come in. We'll talk about electoral stuff. And then Jake Flores is going to join us for even more fun.
There you go. That guy cracks me up.
He's a funny dude.
And Jamie, I know I can only imagine what you have planned for the July 4th version of the Antifada.
I mean, yeah, we've got a special flag burning episode planned just for the birthday of our country.
Audio of it.
Yeah, we might also burn a copy of the Constitution.
It's great for ASMR.
Yeah, get those crackles right up in your ears.
It's definitely a time where you want to definitely get rid of.
My daughter! Check that stuff out. And I'm like, what are you doing?
No, but seriously.
What did she check out? What is it?
It's stuff like where you listen to someone who just like needs to take a sip of water or needs to take a sip of water and they just keep going.
That's so bizarre.
It is.
You know what it is?
So annoying.
It's intimacy that you couldn't normally feel except for this technology we have here. Someone like can whisper in your ear, but they're not actually there. You can just experience
so that's
the sensation.
Not intimacy.
I'm sorry. The whole thing where like people are licking their lips over and over again.
Remember the Rubio mashup we had?
Right.
That was actually
right. It was disgusting.
That was maybe my version.
The,
that
the
I
idea
liked.
That people would listen to that for pleasure is very odd to me.
Rubio was. Oh, sorry.
Be nice. Matt is about to announce his brand new ASMR Twitch project.
Is that right?
He wishes.
It's coming.
No, but seriously, we
play Fortnite and then just spend the whole time going. Oh my god!
I forgot what we even talked about this week. Now after all this whisper talk, no, we had on Aaron Petkoff of the ISO and the New Yorker Union, brand new exciting project in the world, and we talked a little bit about Ocasio-Cortez. Sean went off pretty hard on people who don't understand how systemic change happens. It's great. Check it out. It's coming out on Wednesday, by the way.
And Matt, literary hangover?
There was a special 20-minute episode for premium patron subscribers.
Wow.
Where we talked
getting very
about
fancy.
Catherine Maria Sedgwick, author of Hope Leslie. She's one of the authors that we're going to sort of reanimate, I guess. Maybe that's not the right word. But
I think that's a very interesting word choice for a audio product.
And we also get into some metrics.
She's getting really big now.
If you want to know what our downloads are like, become a member on Patreon. And I just say it on the air. So.
Wow.
That's interesting.
Yep.
All right, folks. We're going to take a quick break. Head into the fun half. The number is 646-257-3920 if you want to be a part of this program. 646-257-3920. You can IM us through the app. I believe we are very close for the Android app to be back up, at least in partial functioning. We're having high-level conversations with Google right now.
Michael's been screaming at Eric Schmidt in the streets.
Like, you idiot. Oh, I did him. I can't believe I regret not doing that. I was too shell-shocked to do anything.
And now
I saw. I told you that story, right? I saw Eric Schmidt on. I was meeting somebody like in Flatiron.
What? Seriously?
It was nothing. I was meeting somebody for dinner in Flatiron, like literally a week after the election. And all that went through my mind was that we had done a show in the primary about how Google people
right,
involved
that,
with Google
whatever
were
that,
manipulating
that black box.
Yeah, it was this whole convoluted like best minds
the groundwork
world are manipulating the data for Hillary, and I was just like, you fucking idiots got beat by Breitbart. Like, what is the matter with you? Moron.
It's supposed to be in hand, you nerd.
Yeah, I know. It's like, look, what, like you were saying, but for once, after destroying like the modern economy, you had one job to manipulate the general election for Hillary Clinton, and you couldn't do it. And now you're like walking around like a doofus being like, hey, go to Burning Man.
All right, folks, 646-257-3920. I guess that was, we're still working on that app. So majorityapp.com.
Hey, everyone. We are live from my backyard where I am smoking a brisket and some ribs. I'm making meats now, smoking these meats here.
A little meat smoking?
It's smoking. So I'm the meat chef. Yeah, someone asked me, do I smoke meat? I'm smoking meat. I'm smoking these meats. I'm smoking meats earlier in the day. I'm smoking these meats. Just set the charcoal up. You set the wood chips up. And then smoking meats, grilling meats. Good smoky flavor. Smoke a brisket for like 12 hours. You smoke lemon chicken. Smoke salmon. You'll love it. Bison sirloin. Ribs and sausage. So I'm looking forward to that. Today we got a brisket on the big guy, and some pork ribs on the green egg. Meat like a brisket. I got ribs in there, finishing off the brisket and the ribs, and I'm just sitting in our backyard, finishing off this brisket and these ribs. But hopefully for Canadian Thanksgiving, you get to eat a lot of brisket and ribs. How many of you guys are eating brisket and ribs tonight? Brisket and ribs. They taste doubly better when you hunted the animal yourself. So what are you guys making for dinner? Brisket and ribs, I hope. Delicious. Brisket and ribs. The ribs and the brisket need to be eaten. I want to try your brisket. I want to try my brisket. It's a pretty tough cut of meat. The ribs and the brisket.
Are you excited to have a rib tonight?
I want my baby back ribs. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Sweet baby raised barbecue sauce. That is going on the ribs. Sweet Baby Ray's and the Sweet Baby Ray's. Sweet Baby Ray's is very good.
Sweet Baby
Ray's. Sweet Baby Ray's. We have just applied the Sweet Baby Ray's. Sweet Baby Ray's. Sweet Baby Ray's. We throw some Sweet Baby Ray's on the ribs. Take it from there. She's waiting for her ribs. I mean, she knows what's coming, and Sweet Baby Ray's. So that's pretty good. Who doesn't like ribs? Everyone likes ribs. Everyone likes ribs.
Excuse me.
Yeah, no, this is what Facebook Live is for. Just